Hello, everybody. Welcome to Elite Wine TV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to Elite Wine TV. Everybody, welcome to Elite Wine TV. I'm your host, Mark Fusco, here for another special edition of the show. I'm here with Aaron Miller of PlumpJack, a winemaker here at PlumpJack. He was kind enough to spend some time with me going through the property, going through the winery, talking about this great property here. I'm excited to taste these wines and to learn, well, we've already learned about it, but to go through all this and learn again about the property and about you. And why don't you tell us who you are and how you got here, and we'll start from there.
Great. And thank you for coming. We appreciate you having here.
Thank you.
And to come here and learn about our wines as well. It's fun to teach you and your audience about what we're doing here. So again, my name is Aaron Miller. I'm a winemaker here at PlumpJack Winery. I come from a background, actually my background was in medicine.
Okay.
Originally. Like many winemakers, we have kind of a science background, but and a lot of us somehow made a transition from medical school into winemaking. I like to say that, you know, while medicine didn't work out, now we're doing some preventative medicine here.
Right.
So making people happy, hopefully lowering your blood pressure. But I started out at UC Davis in pre-med program.
Mm-hmm.
And while I was there, decided that the medical field wasn't what I wanted to do. I worked in an emergency room for 6 months and did not enjoy what I was doing or what I was seeing. So decided to make a transition into another field. And I was lucky that I was at UC Davis in the first place. It's
right.
A great program for winemaking. And I was able to meet a lot of people in the program and try a lot of wines and really gain an interest in wine itself and then also in the winemaking. And so from there, I went to some other wineries in the Napa Valley and did some internships, went overseas for some internships, and ended up going back to school and got my master's degree at UC Davis.
Okay.
for viticulture and enology for winemaking. And it was a really great adventure, a lot of fun, really great time working at all these other wineries. And eventually found my way back here in Oakville at Groth Vineyards and Winery, just down mm-hmm. the street from us here. I was their enologist for a few years.
Okay.
That was a really great experience, wonderful family. Learned a lot about Oakville, learned a lot about winemaking in general. From there, went to Lewis Cellars and was their assistant winemaker for a few years. Another great experience, learned a lot about making really high-end, high-premium wines. And just learned a lot while I was there. And then found my way back in Oakville in 2012, which is when I started here. So 2012 was my first vintage at PlumpJack.
Okay.
Feel very fortunate. It was a very good year, a great year for me to start here.
Right.
Yeah.
So more because I kind of want to understand what the differences are, and I'm sure people out there, what's an enologist do versus any of the other hats that you might wear?
Well, the titles are a little bit different from winery to winery.
Okay.
The job description is a little different from one winery to the next. Generally, an enologist is a lab lead. So an enologist here in the Napa Valley or in California will be taking care of a lot of the chemistry, a lot of the microbiology, a lot of the biology within the winery.
Okay.
So doing a lot of chemical analysis, for example. I was in a position where I was able to do that, but also do a lot of cellar work as well. So I was able to learn a lot about the chemistry of wine, a lot about the analysis, but also able to work from the ground up in the cellar and kind of develop a base foundation knowledge of how to do cellar operations,
okay.
Which I think is important when you're moving up to become a winemaker. You need to know how things are done in a cellar.
Mm-hmm. Well, you don't just get out of UC Davis and just be a winemaker. I mean,
no, you have to learn it. I mean, UC Davis is or any university,
any place, yeah.
just not in the wine industry, but in any field.
Mm-hmm.
College will give you a foundation, it gives you a knowledge. You learn a lot there, but you really develop all of your skills on the job site. You know,
right.
You have to actually gain experience to learn and to grow and to develop and to become an expert at anything. It's more about experience. And so you do it in the cellar, you do it in the lab, and you just you do it out in the vineyards,
right.
And really grow from there.
Nice. And then you came to PlumpJack. So kind of tell me about PlumpJack and how they started. I think it's a real interesting history here too.
Yeah, PlumpJack Winery. The winery itself was founded in 1995. But the property itself has a lot more history than that. Grapes were being grown here in the 1800s, mainly Zinfandel and Riesling. This property was initially a farm. So we have a horse stable, which is what the winery is now. The horse stable was converted into the winery. We also have the tasting room, which was a tractor barn. So the winery itself just used to be a barn that was converted into a winery. And then in the late 1800s, Villa Mount Eden was born, and that was the first winery on this site,
okay.
Making wine from those Zinfandel grapes and from those Riesling grapes. And then obviously during Prohibition and before that, the phylloxera epidemic really wiped out a lot of the wineries in Napa Valley, and Villa Mount Eden was one of those. So it wasn't until the late 60s that the McWilliams family, which this vineyard is now named after, bought the property and started up Villa Mount Eden once again and made wine here for a number of years. And then, as I said, in 1995, we came in and started making wine on the estate. And so it's been, the property itself is very historic.
Okay.
And we've been here for about 20 years now.
All right. You were showing me some areas that you've plowed through some vineyards. You're going to be doing some replanting and.
Yeah, we have some older blocks here that it's time to replant. One of them specifically we just tore out this year, mm-hmm. And that block was about 27 years old, and it started to have some trouble. As far as ripening stuff goes, just wasn't reaching the maturity that we wanted
okay.
to and what we expect out of our fruit. And so we ripped that out and we'll be planting a new block there.
Okay.
And that'll be a long process. It'll take about 4 years before we have any fruit out of those blocks.
Okay. And you were saying you were having trouble ripening. Was that because of some viral stuff or just
right.
it just age?
After a number of years, vines start to pick up virus.
Mm-hmm.
And it depends on the virus, but many
right.
of them will start to inhibit ripening after a number of years. So we were starting to see those effects in this block of Cabernet Sauvignon and decided to fix that. And so we pulled out that block. And like I said, we'll be planting it again. And in about 4 years, we'll start to see some production out of that block again.
Okay. And what grapes are you growing here on the property?
On the estate, we have mostly Cabernet Sauvignon. But we also have a little Petit Verdot. And those are what comprises our estate Cabernet Sauvignon and our reserve Cabernet Sauvignon. We also have a little bit of Sauvignon Blanc and Semillon and Viognier, but those are all for our sister winery, Cade.
Okay.
And that goes into their estate Sauvignon Blanc.
All right. You're kind of describing how the soil, the makeup of the soil and how it I guess permeates or propagates
right.
or whatever word I need to use. Yeah.
It's Napa Valley is a really unique place in general. And you see that here on our property. We only have 40 acres, but on this 40 acres, we have four soil types.
Okay.
And the hills in front of us here, or behind you.
Right. Yeah. Well, that direction, that nice huge hill that I looked at when I was like, so the soil.
those hills over there are the Vaca Range, and mm-hmm. those are a volcanic mountain range.
Okay.
And so over millions of years, those soils have eroded and settled down the valley floor. So on the east side of our property, at the foot of those hills, we have really volcanic soils.
Okay.
A lot of rock, a lot of iron, red soils, very well draining soils. And the Cabernet Sauvignon that we grow on that side of the property is more concentrated, it's more dense, more opulent, blacker fruits, more tannin, more structure. Those are very big wines. As we start to move back this way toward the west, the soil starts to pick up more and more clay. And the fruit in those vines and those grapes there will start to pick up more red fruits. They'll start to pick up more sage, more fresh mint, nice herbaceous notes, and really pick a little more acidity, more brightness.
Okay.
So our estate cab is actually a blend of the entire estate, and that is, you know, the darker fruits on the east side and the redder fruits on the west side, and it makes a really nice blend, really nice highly complex blend. A lot of different types of fruits and. It's just a beautiful wine, a little bit of the sage, a little minerality, and we'll try that wine last actually today.
Okay.
The reserve cab generally, not always, but generally comes from the east side where it's those more black fruited grapes.
Okay. So 40 acres, now I meant to say something about this, that's how many acres the original University of Texas is. That's where I went. That's where I went to college. And when you told me the 40 acres, I started looking around and started picturing the campus. And like, just because you said 40 acres, I was like, really? 40 acres? And I started looking around at myself. And I'm like, okay, yeah, that's probably about right. Yeah. You know, and this.
I have to say, before we continue, I have to say my wife went to A&M.
Oh, no.
So.
Okay, well. You did tell me she was from Texas, so that's okay.
Yeah, yeah.
It's okay. It's all right.
I don't know if we can continue or not.
We're fine because I can't really disparage A&M. They are doing better than we are, so I can't really, you know. It's all right. UT's rebuilding, right? That's what they always say when the team's not doing well, they're rebuilding. But I do believe with Charlie Strong, they are heading in the right direction. I am a huge supporter of how he's handling the program, handling the players, and accountability, and not to disparage the prior coach, but he did a good job when he was coach, and it was time, kind of like, you know, a vine. It's time to make the change. Right. It was time to make the change over at UT. So we'll see in a couple more years how they're doing. I do wish the rivalry on Thanksgiving was still going on, and that
would be fun. I got to go to the last game of that rivalry, and unfortunately A&M did not come out ahead,
but no. That's okay. And that's all, I mean, that's all about college football politics and A&M and UT's athletic directors being stupid. I'll put it kindly, being stupid and not seeing that they need to keep that going. Anyway,
Back to the wine.
We're gonna a couple more things. These are the questions my dad had asked, and I thought they were interesting. So I like to get that. So out of all the episodes I've ever done, I've never either addressed or asked anyone, where in the world do you get the vines? They don't just spring up out of the ground. I mean, so if I was going to start a winery, there's two ways I could get my vines. So how would I do that?
Yeah, generally there's two ways you can get vines. One is to get certified wood through a nursery.
Okay.
The nursery grows wood just from the tips of the vines, and they actually will treat the tips so that they should be able to kill any virus or any bacteria and anything that might be in the wood.
Mm-hmm.
And they grow that up so that they are clean. Very clean wood, and they're certified as clean, and they're tested. And so you can buy your plant material from the nursery directly, and you actually buy the rootstock and the vinifera clone grafted, and you just go out and plant it. Or you can do what some people like to do and find a vineyard that they like. They might have a friend growing grapes in the area. That has a very nice block, and they like that Cabernet Sauvignon, for example, and they want that exact clone. And they might just take field cuttings from that block and strip the buds off and actually put buds on their existing vines.
Okay.
So they'll cut their vines down to about maybe knee height and then stick the buds in those vines.
Okay.
And then once the growing season comes around, those buds should push and they'll start to grow. That clone from that their their friend's block.
Right.
And the upside to that is that you may be getting a really nice clone. The downside could be that you might be getting a virus that you and the original grower were unaware of.
Right.
So you could be spreading a virus into your block. Or you might just have a block that won't last as long because it's starting out with virus.
Right. Okay. So, I mean, I thought that was just interesting. I mean, I had also never had brought up in any type of educational thing I've done, and never really asked anyone, even off camera, asking where how you get the vines. It's just, it's one of those things you read and say, yeah, they had clippings, but they were talking about like the historical, like they brought clippings from the old world, of thing. Not, well, what happens if you want to start one here? And then just one of the things we were talking about, the rose bushes. Not every winery does it, but you know, having the rose bushes at the end of vine of the vineyards.
Right.
So
right, and we have rose bushes at the end of our vine rows, and the folklore, the old wives' tale, it would be that the rose bushes are at the end of the vines as an indicator, basically. So they would show signs of mildews before the grapevines would get those mildews, powdery mildew, downy mildew. There's different pests that rose bushes get that grapevines also get. So that would be the tale. So you know that when your rose bush has this mildew that you need to take action in your vineyard.
Right.
But I don't think that's necessarily true. I think it's just a nice story.
Just a nice story, and they look nice.
And, and they're just a beautiful fixture, like ornamental piece in the vineyard.
And again, my dad is the one that came up with that one. And somewhere, like I told you, I knew something that in the past somewhere I had read that, probably in one of the books, and I just couldn't remember why there was a reason for this. And I told him, I said, well, I think it has something to do with like pests or something. Right. I don't know. And he goes, well, ask. I'm like, okay, well, I'll ask. And now we have the reason why. So let's get into the wines.
Okay.
And so we're going to start with your reserve Chardonnay.
Right.
And you can tell me a little bit about this wine.
Yeah, of course. So this reserve Chardonnay is in a style of wine, a style of Chardonnay that most people probably don't associate with the Napa Valley. A lot of people think Napa Valley Chardonnay and they think 100% new oak, or 100% oak anyway, 100% oak fermentation and aging, and 100% malolactic fermentation. So you get really viscous, rich, maybe a little bit of butterscotch, you know, caramel notes. However, this wine is made in a completely different style. So this is more of a refreshing style. It's more about focusing on the fruit, on the Chardonnay itself. The Chardonnay grape actually has a lot to offer. It has really nice fruits. So it has nice pear, nice apple. It can have really great tropical fruits. And when you do a lot of oak in your fermentations and aging, and you do the malolactic fermentation, you tend to really mask that. And so we really want to keep that exposed and just really let that be what speaks to the consumers. And so to achieve that, we do mostly stainless steel fermentation. We ferment about 60, 65, maybe even 70%, depending on the vintage, in stainless steel. In stainless steel tanks or in stainless steel drums, which we can still do the batonnage, we can still stir, pick up the lees and help to build body.
Right.
And so that stainless steel fermentation really keeps the wine fresher, really maintains that fruit. So you still get a lot of the apple, the fresh Bartlett pear, and a lot of that tropical fruit. It really shines through in the wine. And then on top of that, we don't do malolactic fermentation. So we prevent that from happening by adding a little bit of sulfur. And that really keeps the wine fresh and vibrant as well, more on the palate.
Mm-hmm.
So the malolactic fermentation, what you're getting there, basically what's happening in this process is you're adding a bacteria when you want malolactic fermentation. You're adding a bacteria that will convert malic acid to lactic acid. That's basically like turning the acid, malic acid is what is in apples, basically turning that really nice, bright, crisp acid into something much softer, like lactic acid, which is what you would have maybe in milk, for example.
Right.
So it really softens the wine. But we really want to keep that really bright, really pretty acidity, because that really kind of brings through the freshness of the fruit and just keeps it really lively.
Right.
But doing the little bit of oak that we do, we have a lot of the stirring that we're doing that helps to build the body, so it's still really rich. We don't lose any of that richness. And then we're also getting a little bit more complexity, so adding a few more layers in there. The oak adds a little bit of kind of a smoke or a flint, and also maybe a little bit of nuttiness. So add just a few more layers to the wine, mm-hmm. so it's not just one-dimensional, just fruit.
Okay. And well, we'll get through this, and we'll talk about some stuff we saw in the winery, because I thought that was pretty interesting too. And you know, when I initially put my nose in, I got the apple, but I also feel like I get like a spiced apple.
I think that's the oak kind of adding a little bit of complexity to it, so it's giving it a little bit of that, you know, almost like a warming spices, a little bit of cinnamon, mm-hmm. that kind of complements the apple.
And the cinnamon was exactly where I was going with that, with the spiced apple. And it really is crisp. It's got really nice acid to it. You know, really say medium plus to high acid to it. Mm-hmm. So it's going to really cut through anything that you might be eating.
Right.
And I experienced this, you know, at your other property this morning, that white wines probably in general are easy, but this is a wine I could. Perfect day, like I could totally just sit out here and just drink this out here. By the way, this is a beautiful, you know, awesome little setting we got here, and it's like I think the second time I've done outdoors. So I was really happy when they said we're gonna taste outside. I literally was like the light, my eyes lit up, and I just kind of yelled cool. I mean, I was like, yeah, all right, because the day has just been beautiful ever since I've been here. Right. So, yeah. But back to the wine, you know, this would be perfect for today, to sit out here, maybe if you had like a little fruit and cheese tray type of thing.
Right. It's actually really a really versatile style of wine.
Right.
I mean, it's you can just sit here and drink it. You don't need food with it.
I mean,
it does stand up on its own, but at the same time, it's a perfect food wine. So it pairs well with a multitude of foods, you know, from, you know, your rich seafoods, you know, lobster, that sort of thing, or lighter foods like the fish, or you can even do, you know, a lot of meats with it as well.
Like maybe those tostadas we talked about earlier?
Yeah, right.
There's a mustard grill, right? Is that what it's called, mustard grill?
Yeah, those fish tostadas, yeah.
Fish tostadas. I'm not a seafood lover at all, but Dad might try that out. So yeah, funny story, when one of the other wineries, which everyone's already seen it at this point, but the winery I went to last night, we had a little food pairing, and one of them was smoked salmon on a little like crostini type of thing. And I told him ahead of time before we got on camera, I don't like this stuff. And I didn't like it, but the pairing went well.
Right.
And I appreciated the pairing. And the good thing was that I didn't have any unnatural reactions to it.
That's
so
great. Yeah.
I'm not allergic to seafood. I just don't like it.
As far as pairings go for me, my philosophy is more about balanced wine, balanced mm-hmm. food.
Yeah.
Than it is about you need to have Chardonnay with, you know, a fish, and you need to have a steak with a cab. You know, I feel like if you have a nice balanced wine, so it has all those components, it has really nice structure, nice acid, it's got good richness, you know, it's got just all the pieces, and then your food is the same way. It needs to have the kind of fatty component, the salt, you know, the richness, and, you know, has all those, the acid has to have all those different components. And so if you have a well-balanced meal and a well-balanced wine, then I think you'll end up being very happy.
Yeah.
With the pairing.
One of the former employers I worked for, we had a guest that came in pretty regularly, and they would drink Pinot Grigio with their steak. Mm-hmm. And we had a steak butter we would put on there. And, you know, and she knew I was into wine and all that. And she turned to me and said, I know I'm not supposed to have this. I was like, do you like it? She goes, yeah. I said, then that's fine. You like that? I said, I can see why. It was more about probably the steak butter that was put on there and the acidity and all that. But, you know, I said to her, I said, I can see why you like it. There's nothing wrong with it. If that's how you like it, then who cares about the rules? That's
right.
That's the perfect wine exactly. for you, right? You know, you know, I think most people still kind of stick with, you know, whites go with one thing or go with a certain category and reds go with another because there's a
comfort level and
there's a reason for it, but doesn't mean you can't. You know, if I wanted to have a big juicy steak and drink the Chardonnay, doesn't mean I couldn't do it. If I like that flavor combination, I mean, who's to say that you don't do contrasting stuff or even if it's complementary in some way. So, yeah, I mean, food pairing is, the rules are guidelines. They're not rules. It's whatever you want to do.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah.
But this is a lovely wine. I really like that apple. And then there was something else I just caught off of that. You know, I could, and there are times with white wines I will sometimes struggle with the nose because white wines tend to be really light and they don't tend to be as in your face as red wines. But this is one I think I could just kind of sit back and just kind of smell for a while and you'll
pick up new flavors, new aromatics as the wine changes. You know, as it warms up a little bit, the volatiles will change.
Mm-hmm. I think it's outstanding. I like it a lot. Absolutely love it a lot. Now we're going to move on to Merlot. And I do love Merlot, so I'm excited. I'm always excited about trying Merlot. It's well before the whole sideways effect. I loved it, and I still love it. And
I've held on.
Yeah, I've flat out said that I love it. So
yeah, and we've continued producing it. Yeah.
And I mean, I know it's now probably almost two decades since the movie, right? We're pretty close to that.
Maybe at least 15 over, years.
Yeah, we're about 15 years from the movie. My feeling on my end of things is that that effect isn't as great as it used to be. I think Merlot seems to be getting popularity again. You don't have people, you know, turning their nose up to it, saying that Pinot Noir is the greatest grape ever known to man.
Right.
Since you produce a Merlot, are you finding that you're making more of it in general in the Valley or?
Well, for us in particular, we're not making more.
Okay.
We are, you know, we're making the same amount we've been making for quite a while.
Right.
But we don't have any problems selling this wine.
Yeah.
I mean, people love Merlot. They a lot of people don't realize they love Merlot. They have forgotten that they love Merlot because maybe they were affected by the movie. Maybe they were affected just by kind of a decrease in quality around that time, which is probably, you know, why the movie was made in the first place. Not right. why it was made, but why they picked on Merlot specifically.
Yeah.
But I think that at that time there definitely was a decrease in quality. Merlot was the big grape. It was what Cabernet Sauvignon is now, really, you know.
Okay.
So a lot of people were making Merlot and possibly making it and growing it where they shouldn't have been.
Mm-hmm.
And not really getting the quality that they should have been getting. And so people started to see that and they changed to other varietals.
Right.
I think that now you're seeing a lot of people that continued to make it were always making it in the right places. I was growing it in the right places. And I think that we're one of those wineries. And so we've held on to our belief that Merlot is a great wine. And we've made it throughout. And when you try this, I think you'll see, just like a lot of our guests when they come to the winery, see that they actually, you know, they really love Merlot.
Mm-hmm.
They're usually surprised when they have this wine.
Right.
And they, you know, they think, wow, I had forgotten about
right.
Merlot. I'd forgotten about how great it can be. And so we source this from a really great, we actually get this fruit down in Oak Knoll, which is a little bit cooler than Oakville. But it's warmer than Carneros, and it really is the perfect place for growing Merlot. The climate is just outstanding, and it's a really rich, really dense Merlot. We use just off the nose, you'll you'll probably first get, besides a lot of fruit, you'll get a little smokiness, mm-hmm. a lot of spice, really, really sweet oak. And there is just a touch of American oak in there. Okay. So mostly French oak, but we have about 10 to 15% American oak, depending on the vintage, on the wine. And that really adds a little bit of that sweet element, kind of right, that smoky, toasted component on the nose. But really a lot of fruit coming through there, and the palate is just really dense, really opulent. Some people say it drinks like a cab.
It's good. It's tasty. I really enjoy it. I don't think I would say it drinks like a cab. I think it really does drink like a Merlot, but it's a full-bodied Merlot. It's not thin. It's not a watery or weak Merlot. It's a Merlot that can stand up to, fattier foods.
Right.
But it still has, there's still a softness and velvetiness to it that you may not get from cabs.
I think that when people say that they are thinking more along the lines of what you're saying, that it's a firm Merlot. It's quite a bold Merlot.
Right.
But it does still have the finesse that Merlot has. It has more of the red fruits. It has a little bit more kind of a brighter acidity. It's a Merlot through and through, but at the same time, it just has a little bit more power than some Merlots have.
What I like to do when we have the whole Merlot Cabernet Sauvignon thing, this also doubles as my white background when I'm doing stuff. Color-wise, they're pretty close, but mm-hmm. you know what?
And that's a vintage thing as well. 2012, we had a lot of color
okay.
in our red varietals.
Okay. But Jeff Kruth, who's a master sommelier and the head of the Guild of Sommeliers, and he's out here somewhere in California, I think actually specifically in San Francisco. But when he talks about his deductive tasting seminars when he does them at TechSom, which is the Texas Sommelier Conference, mm-hmm. if you don't know what that is, they talk about in a blind setting for us as somms, if you say Merlot and it's cab, if you say cab, it's Merlot, they're not going to worry about it because... at the end of the day, a lot of times it's hard to distinguish the two from each other, especially if they have element. Especially if it's not a 100% of that variety, right. it's kind of hard to say. Well, this is a majority of that or the other. Not that you can't, but they recognize that sometimes you can trick the finest blind taster into thinking that a cab is a Merlot and the other way around. For me. Exactly how I describe this Merlot with that finesse and elegance and velvetiness, it's a different kind versus having finesse and elegance in a cab.
Right.
That is, if I was blind tasting this, I probably would say Merlot. And it's not just to sit there and pat myself on the back that I'm confident I could pick it as Merlot versus cab, but there's just something about Merlot that I feel that I... I'm usually good at saying this is at least a majority Merlot wine versus a majority cab wine, but I've been tricked before. It's got to be this, and found out it was more cab than Merlot. But
right, that's great. I mean, we want it to be Merlot. We don't want it right. to be. I mean, we have an estate Cabernet Sauvignon and a reserve Cabernet Sauvignon. Mm-hmm. We don't need to be selling three Cabernet Sauvignons. Right. So we definitely want it to be distinct. We want it to be distinctly Merlot.
And I think it succeeds on that. I mean, if you had sat there and put this glass in front of me and said, this is one of our cabs, I'd probably kind of in my head go, it's kind of okay, maybe it's a cab, but I kind of think you might be wrong.
Right.
But since you tell me it's cab, I'm going to trust that you're telling me it's right, and I'm just going to go with it and just say, okay, it's a good wine. They tell me it's cab. I think it's different, but, I'll just go with it. But of course, the answer's right there in front of me. I know it's a Merlot. I saw you pour it, you know, so I know that's what it is. But, you know, everything tells me that's what it is. And I appreciate that. And that's, I think that's where the upshot is. I appreciate that it's a Merlot. Yes, it's a full bodied Merlot, and it can stand up to pretty much the same type of food
right.
that you would put with a cab. And I think that's one of the things with Merlots. I mean, there are some lighter Merlots, and they're good too. And they really can't stand up to the other foods. But I think that's where many way people ignore Merlot. They forget about it because they think if they're going to have a big steak or something that commands mm-hmm. cab, they have to have, they can't have Merlot. We can't have that. And again, we talk about food pairing. I mean, what you think goes with it is what should go with it, not what me or you or anyone else says. You know, if I say yeah. this can stand up to a big steak and you don't think it can, then that's your opinion, you know?
Yeah. No, this definitely can. This is a great food wine again.
Yeah.
I mean, it's one of the best foods that I've found with it, not or just styles of foods really, is just grilled foods.
Right.
When you're in the backyard and you got the grill going, this will go great with your burger. It'll go great with your steak. It'll go great with your portobello mushroom, what have mm-hmm. you. It's just that little smoky element in this wine that really kind of links the two together and makes it a really great pairing.
And I think really, you know, power suggestions is powerful. I mean, that's why it's called the power suggestion. Talking about the whole grill thing, I took another sip, and it took me back to yesterday at lunch at, was it Bob's Southern Barbecue or whatever? It's up by Calistoga.
Buster's,
yeah. Not Bob's. Buster's.
Great spot. Yeah. Great spot. I hope you didn't get the hot sauce. Though.
I did.
Oh, that's hot.
It was
sauce.
Beautiful. I was loving it.
That's hot.
My dad
hot
got
sauce.
The mild. I got the hot because I'm like, it's hot. I can take it. It's, it can't be that hot. Not here in California. And, it was hot.
It's hot.
But it was good. It was good hot. And I, at first I thought my goodness, I might have gotten some of the too hot, and it's pretty
I'm
rare for me.
I'm glad you enjoyed it, because I can't get through a whole dish with that hot sauce.
Yeah.
I need to go with the mild on
yeah.
that one.
Yeah, but it was good, and there was still flavor to it. It wasn't just all heat. It was mm-hmm. it wasn't like going to like a wing place where you have the hottest wing sauce and all it is heat.
Right.
There was flavor to it, so it was great. And so it took me back to that, like that type of, like, maybe not having that particular sauce, but having a barbecue mm-hmm. sauce. And when you said all that, I took a sip, and I'm like, wow. It I kind of wish I'd had that wine yesterday at lunch mm-hmm. Instead of the Coke that I had. So, but yeah, excellent. I really enjoy it. All right, now, and let's go back to the Chardonnay. Is also
this is 2013,
right? But that's like the Merlot. It's not grown on property.
It's not grown on property. No,
right.
This is from a couple of different vineyard sites. One up in Santa Elena, just north of here.
Okay.
And the other down in Carneros.
Okay.
So the Santa Elena a little bit warmer. And that's often where you pick up more of those tropical notes, those warmer
right.
regions for Chardonnay. And then down in Carneros, we get more of those really nice apple and pear notes.
Right.
Yeah, a little cooler down there.
And that's something that maybe not everybody, people who live here probably know that, but people that don't live here don't quite understand that the farther south you go, it gets a little cooler, right?
Yeah, yeah, but a lot of ocean influence. So the southern end of the Napa Valley is really almost right on the San Francisco Bay.
Right.
That part of the San Francisco Bay is called San Pablo Bay, but it's right on the bay there. And so it's a lot of influence from the bay, and it's much cooler. And the Napa Valley is only about 30 miles from the south to the north. And you'll have in Carneros in the south to Calistoga in the north, you'll probably have about a 15 degree temperature swing.
Okay.
On our warm days. So it's pretty significant.
Right. Yeah, I think it's just counterintuitive. Most people think the farther north you go anywhere, it's going to be colder.
Most places,
yeah.
In most valleys, that is the case,
right?
But it's not so here.
Cool. All right, so we're going to, so this is grown in the estate in the McWilliams Oakville Vineyard, yes?
Yeah, this is the 2012.
I can read, by the way.
This is the 2012 PlumpJack Estate Cabernet Sauvignon. So this is all off of this estate here. Like I was mentioning earlier, this is actually composed of the entire estate. So it's from fruit mm-hmm. on the east side and fruit on the west side. So it's got the black fruits and the red fruits. So there's really great complexity to it, and, you know, a lot of layers. You have, you know, the black cherry, black currant. You can even have some redder fruits like nice ripe raspberry.
Right.
But also just a little bit of like a sage character, which is very typical on this property. One of the really fun things about our wine is really kind of stands out. And also a minerality to it, almost like crushed granite, crushed rocks. The oak is really well integrated on this. It's not sitting on top. It's really silky, velvety tannin.
This is nice. I really get the fruit. I get a lot of the fruit on it, and it is that red and black fruit. On the nose, I thought I was getting a little bit of blue fruit on it, but on the palate, I felt like it was really the darker fruit, darker red fruit, black fruit, a little bit of, I would say, brambliness. So there's minerality there with that. We talked about earlier at Odette that sometimes minerality is really just a catch-all to things that are not fruit or floral. And we were having the Chardonnay, and when I said minerality, I meant really minerality, like licking rock type, what most people think of minerality. But having that woodish type of flavor on the palate, and there's even, on the nose, there's I almost want to say caramel.
Yeah, it's a little bit of the oak coming through.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So really nice. And then
sweetness to the nose.
Much bigger tannin, or much more tannin than the Merlot. So, this is, again, if I had these two in front of me,
right?
Especially when you go side by side, this would no doubt is Cab. I would never ever think this is a Merlot. And this, I would be like, I'm pretty sure it's Merlot. If you told me it was Cab, I'd probably go, okay, fine, it's Cab, but still think it's a Merlot. These are exactly what they should be. They're really nice. It's really good. And we all have our personal preferences with wine. All three of these hit those preferences for me. So, and it's not that I told them and said, hey, this is the kind of wine I like, and was make sure you pour it.
This is pretty much our lineup.
Yeah, this is the lineup. Yeah. It's not like there was any other choice. I've gone to wineries that produce like 30 wines,
Right.
And I've gone to wineries that, produce two or three, and that's what we do. I haven't been to a winery, but there's a winery I know that just produces one wine. That's it. But these are exactly if I wanted a cab, this is what I would want. If I was looking for a Napa cab, this is what I want. If I want Napa Merlot,
that's
or
a great compliment.
New World Merlot. That, yeah. So I want, if I want Chardonnay from this area of the country, this is exactly what I would like to have. So far, every Chardonnay I've had in interviews has been this, at least base style. Maybe one was more Chablis, maybe one was more white Burgundy, but it wasn't the buttered popcorn,
right?
Which is not my preference. I will drink it because sometimes it's kind of nice to have that.
I think it's nice. I've made that wine in the past, that style, and I enjoy it. I really like that style as well.
Right.
I just appreciate this one a little more. I think that this pairs better with food.
I think so too, yeah.
And that's why I like this.
Again, preferences, and I, no problem telling you if I didn't like it, I would tell you I didn't like it. Of the three, I like the Merlot the best. It's just... nothing wrong with this cab at all. I think it's fantastic. But if I was going to pick a wine that I wanted to just finish drinking, not that I wouldn't finish any of these, but the Merlot, I just kind of like it. There's just something a little bit different about it. I like the finesse about it.
It stands out as a Merlot.
Yeah. And I really like it. If I didn't have the Merlot in front of me, then it'd be a different story. But I really like the Merlot a lot. And I absolutely appreciate you taking the time to spend with me.
Yeah, of course.
And you know, this has been a wonderful experience to come to both of the properties today. This was incredible to come out here and sit up here and enjoy some great wine outside, be able to enjoy the day, because, you know, most of my day has been either in a car or inside of a winery. So I haven't really been able to do outside stuff the past couple
and
days. So
it's a beautiful November day in the Napa Valley.
Yeah, this is absolutely incredible. And I truly appreciate you taking the time out of your day to work with me. And because I know there's still work to be done in the winery. This is not downtime necessarily. And I mean, I know it's not as busy as harvest time.
We're getting close.
Yeah,
we're getting close. We've had a weekend off. That's good.
That's good. Yeah, yeah. Right.
Yeah. It's been a while.
I totally understand that. Yeah. Just coming from somebody that works pretty much every weekend.
Yeah.
It's nice to have the weekend off when everybody else is off, you know. Yeah. It's nice to have that occasionally. But I'm very pleased with the wines, impressed with the wines, and look forward to having more of those in the future. And
yeah,
I appreciate you coming out or having me over.
Yeah. No, thank you for including us.
Awesome.
And interviewing us. It's an honor, and I appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Folks, as always, I just want to thank all of you for stopping by. Of course, I'll have a link below for the winery, so check them out. These wines are a little bit more widespread than Odette. These can be found at restaurants and also retail.
Restaurants and like
boutique
wine shops.
Right. Yeah, you're not going to find them at the grocery store, but
primarily restaurants.
Yeah, restaurants, and then of course through the winery.
Here. Yeah,
So I'm sure they can order stuff as long as you ship to the state. They can order it.
Right. Or come visit.
Yeah, or come visit. Yeah, it's a beautiful property, so come out here and check it out. But I'll have the link to that, so you can check that out. Of course, click the links above to friend me up. And of course, every time someone sits to my left, I have to say I'm not pointing at him. You want to hit the PayPal button over there? Just hit the PayPal button. And the guy to the left never knows I'm going to do that. So they're like, what in the world is he doing? So hit the PayPal button over there, and you can send me a couple ducats so I can get back home. Don't worry, I'll be home. I'm already home because that's how I edit. I don't edit on the laptop. But appreciate it, and we will see everyone again next time.